Klaus Fuchs was a brilliant physicist with a dangerous secret. While working on the Manhattan Project, he quietly passed everything he knew about building the atomic bomb to the Soviet Union. His betrayal helped the Soviets build their own bomb sooner than anyone thought possible, shattering America's nuclear monopoly and fueling the Cold War arms race. Why would Fuchs risk everything to arm the enemy? To answer this question, we have to go back to the beginning, to Rüsselsheim, West Germany, where Fuchs was born on December 29, 1911. His father, Emil, was a Lutheran pastor and a committed socialist. He raised his children with a simple motto, do what is right, whatever the cost. Klaus followed his father by joining the German Socialist Party, the SPD. But as the Nazis grew stronger, he fully embraced communism, believing the communists were the only ones brave enough to resist Hitler. At the University of Kiel, he stood up to the Nazis, and in return, the Nazi thugs beat him and threw him into the river. He lost three of his front teeth. When the German parliament, the Reichstag, burnt down in February 1933, weeks after Hitler became chancellor, the Nazis used it as an excuse to crush their political enemies. The Fuchs family fled to Berlin, but Klaus knew he could no longer stay in Germany. He escaped to England, where he studied physics at the University of Bristol under Neville Mott. It was in Bristol that Fuchs first met Rudolf Piles, who was visiting. Piles was one of the key scientists in Britain's nuclear weapons program, Tube Alloys, and a professor at the University of Birmingham. Fuchs's intellect impressed Piles, who needed a research assistant for an urgent project after German chemists Otto Hahn and Fritz Strassmann made an extraordinary discovery in December 1938. They bombarded uranium with neutrons and found barium in the fragments, an element far lighter than uranium. This could only mean that the uranium nucleus had somehow split apart. At first, the Germans didn't grasp the meaning of their discovery. Weeks later, Liz Meitner, a Jewish physicist who had fled the Nazis, and her nephew Otto Frisch understood. They realized that the uranium atom had fissioned into two smaller nuclei, krypton and barium, releasing an enormous amount of energy. Frisch gave it a name that would echo through history, nuclear fission. Then, in 1939, Niels Bohr, working alongside John Wheeler, showed why this reaction was so explosive. It wasn't uranium-238, the common isotope that splits so easily, but the rare uranium-235. When U-235 absorbs a neutron, it becomes highly unstable U-236. That nucleus shatters into two atoms, releasing more neutrons, which slam into other U-235s, creating a chain reaction that could trigger an explosion of unprecedented power. When Piles and Frisch calculated how much uranium-235 was needed, the answer shocked them. A bomb could be small enough and light enough to be dropped from an aircraft. Their memorandum was the first proposal proving that an atomic weapon was feasible. Piles tasked Fuchs with calculating the efficiency of separating U-235 from the much more abundant U-238 to make a bomb. Piles thought Fuchs was the perfect protege. What he didn't realize was that Fuchs had already made contact with the Soviets. In April 1941, Fuchs attended a party in London hosted by the head of the German Communist Party in Britain. There, he was introduced to a man calling himself Johnson, in reality, Colonel Simon Kremer, a Soviet intelligence officer operating out of the Soviet embassy. They spoke casually about the potential uses of atomic energy, the beginning of Fuchs's secret relationship with Soviet intelligence. Only a month later, he joined Piles in Birmingham as his assistant, cleared by MI5 despite acknowledging some connection with the Communist Party. The only evidence against him came from the Gestapo, which British intelligence dismissed as a Nazi ploy. As he settled into the Piles household, Fuchs became almost like a son to Rudolf Piles and his wife Jenia. Yet, as they embraced him, he betrayed them, feeding the Soviets information from Britain's atomic bomb project, including the groundbreaking Frisch-Piles memorandum.
Rudolf Piles and his wife were the first real loving family that Fuchs had been with. And at the same time, however, he was betraying them as individuals.
Professor Frank Close, a nuclear physicist at Oxford who knew Piles personally, has written the definitive book on this story, Trinity, The Treachery and Pursuit of the Most Dangerous Spy in History, which much of this research draws upon. Fuchs would meet Colonel Kremer on a bus carrying top secret documents in an envelope. When it was time to get off, he'd leave the bundle on the seat for Kremer to pick up. After each handover, Fuchs developed a nasty dry cough, which Jenia Pearls later read as a sign of guilt.
The real problem for him was that he was betraying, at the same time, his closest friends.
Although he was betraying his closest friends, he convinced himself he was helping an ally. After Germany invaded the Soviet Union in June 1941, and Churchill pledged full support to Moscow, Fuchs believed he got the green light to aid a wartime ally in defeating fascism. His most devastating betrayal came when he joined the Manhattan Project. After Pearl Harbor brought the U.S. into the war, it quickly took the lead in nuclear research with its immense resources. In Chicago, Enrico Fermi and his team built the world's first nuclear reactor, achieving a self-sustaining nuclear chain reaction. The U.S. Army launched the Manhattan Project in 1942 to build an atomic bomb, and Britain's own project was folded into it under the American leadership of General Leslie Groves. By 1943, London cleared Klaus Fuchs to take part.
I was astonished to discover in the archives a letter to the head of the British delegation, which showed that MI5 was certainly by now more concerned about Fuchs's, as they called it, communist proclivities. And this letter recommended that we should not inform the Americans of this. So this clearly was a ploy to ensure that Fuchs was part of the project, because by that stage, he was an important part of it.
Fuchs arrived at Los Alamos, New Mexico in August 1944 to join Piles in the theoretical division. By then, scientists had realized that plutonium could serve as bomb fuel and was potentially more practical than uranium since it could be produced in reactors. His assignment was the project's toughest, designing the plutonium implosion bomb. He calculated how explosive charges could compress the plutonium core and modeled the shockwaves and timing needed to ensure the implosion was perfectly symmetrical, otherwise the bomb would fail. He gave the Soviets a virtual blueprint of Trinity, a plutonium implosion bomb, including a sketch with dimensions, the initiator design, the tamper specifications, the types of explosives used, and even the expected yield. When President Truman informed Stalin of a new weapon of unusual destructive force, Stalin showed no surprise. The Soviets knew what to expect before Trinity detonated in the New Mexico desert on July 16, 1945, the world's first atomic explosion. The initial euphoria of Trinity turned to horror after Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Rudolf Piles admitted, "Nobody could look at the reports and the pictures about Hiroshima and Nagasaki with anything but horror. And nobody would feel any pride at having a hand in bringing this about. But this was war. And in war, death, suffering, and destruction are unavoidable." A new enemy emerged after the war. Once an ally against Hitler, the Soviet Union was now the greatest threat to the Western world. Within months, the U.S. tested its nuclear weapons at Bikini Atoll, using a fleet of obsolete and captured warships as targets, as a message to Moscow of America's nuclear might. The alliance that had defeated Hitler was gone. The Cold War had begun. And yet, once he returned to Britain, he still continued passing secrets to the Soviets. In the summer of 1946, Fuchs returned to the UK to lead the theoretical physics division at the new Atomic Energy Research Establishment at Harwell, just south of Oxford. With the United States shutting off nuclear cooperation through the McMahon Act, Britain was now determined to build its own bomb. And even before MI5 cleared him, Fuchs was already at the center of that effort. This was also the first time someone noticed something about him was off. Harwell security officer Henry Arnold was a former military intelligence man who lived by a simple rule. "I accept no form of clearance and am only satisfied if I am able to form my own opinion of each person who comes under my charge." Arnold thought Fuchs was too cooperative. When he asked senior staff to hand him their safe keys before leaving the office, most scientists found the request absolutely outrageous, except Fuchs, who complied. To Arnold, that eagerness wasn't a sign of trust, but a red flag. Fuchs even gave Arnold a written list of his daily movements, as if to prove he had nothing to hide. Arnold also learned from Fuchs's boss that he had once belonged to the Soviet Cultural Society in Bristol. By late 1946, MI5 became more suspicious of Fuchs. Joe Archer, head of the section overseeing security vetting, reviewed Fuchs's file and came to a blunt conclusion. "Fuchs is a possible, I would prefer to say probable, Russian agent." Although Archer wanted him removed immediately, others at MI5 feared it would cripple the bomb program if they were wrong. As a compromise, they monitored his mail and phone calls, but nothing suspicious turned up. That's because Moscow had ordered Fuchs to lie low for most of 1947 in light of a defector exposing a Soviet spy ring in Canada. Despite lingering doubts about his loyalties, Harwell made Fuchs's appointment permanent. The Ministry of Supply, which oversaw atomic energy research, told MI5, "It has been decided that the advantages gained by Harwell through the undoubted ability of Dr. Fuchs outweigh the slight security risk."
Of course, as it turned out, it was even worse than it might be.
On August 29, 1949, the Soviets detonated their first atomic bomb, Joe 1, in Kazakhstan. It was completely unexpected, and it stunned the West. The plutonium implosion bomb was virtually identical to the Fat Man bomb dropped over Nagasaki. I asked Professor Close how much Fuchs's espionage sped up the Soviet bomb.
Well, as a scientist, that was one of the interesting questions that I was trying to assess. And I think the idea of 1 to 2 years is indeed probably pretty realistic.
Soon after the Soviets detonated their bomb, another shock arrived. A U.S. counterintelligence program called Venona managed to decode Soviet cables, revealing that a British scientist at Los Alamos had spied for the Soviets. The Soviets made the fatal error of reusing a one-time pad. That reuse created patterns, allowing a gifted American linguist named Meredith Gardner to decrypt this particularly damning cable sent from New York to Moscow in 1944. It reported that the spy, codenamed Rest, had delivered the third part of a scientific paper, MSN-12, on gaseous diffusion, the process of enriching uranium for a bomb. The message noted that Rest feared he might have to leave the United States soon, and referred to tensions between the islanders, the British, and the townsmen, the Americans, over atomic cooperation. Only a handful of scientists in the Manhattan Project had worked on diffusion theory, and Fuchs's movements matched the timeline in the cable. MI5 decided to confront him. On December 21, 1949, MI5 interrogator Jim Skardon sat down with Fuchs, who was calm and courteous. "While you were in New York, I allege that you were in touch with a Soviet official or a Soviet representative and passed on to that person information bearing on your work." Fuchs's jaw dropped. After a pause, he replied, "I don't think so. I cannot assist you, and I strongly deny that I have ever been responsible for such a leakage." Skardon pressed harder. "I am in possession of precise information which shows that you have been guilty of espionage on behalf of the Soviet Union. For example, during the time that you were in New York, you passed to them information concerning your work." Fuchs deflected. "I don't think so. I don't understand. Perhaps you will tell me what the evidence is. I have not done any such thing." For 4 hours, he never lost his composure. By the end, Skardon wasn't sure he had the right man. His report the next day read, "If he is innocent, it is surprising that he should receive allegations of this kind so coolly, but perhaps this squares with his mathematical approach to life." A second interview fared no better. He even told MI5's director, Dick White, "You're barking up the wrong tree. Fuchs is innocent." Fuchs appeared calm on the surface, but the years of secrecy gnawed at him, and he couldn't take it anymore. He had grown close to Erna Skinner, the wife of a colleague with whom he shared an emotional, if not a physical, relationship. In a moment of weakness, he confessed to her that he had leaked vital information about the bomb project to people he was never meant to. Fuchs requested another meeting with Skardon. He was ready to come clean. On January 24, 1950, Klaus Fuchs confessed. He told Skardon he had been passing secrets to the Russians from mid-1942 until about a year ago, though it had actually begun in 1941. He admitted in broad terms that he had passed everything he could get his hands on, including the manner of making the atomic bomb. At the end of the meeting, Fuchs added quietly, "I still believe in communism, but not as it is practiced in Russia today." When he visited the wife of a Harwell colleague who had been hospitalized, Fuchs explained his actions as a personal duty. "Everyone has their own conscience to live with and must obey its commands." After his arrest, Fuchs gave a different explanation. When his friend and mentor, Rudolf Piles, visited him at Brixton Prison, a detective overheard him say, "Knowledge of atomic research should not be the private property of any one country, but instead shared with the world for the benefit of mankind." In March 1950, Fuchs went on trial at London's Old Bailey. The evidence against him was so sensitive it couldn't be used in court. The prosecution deliberately avoided admitting that the Soviets had a working bomb, let alone that Fuchs had provided them with the implosion design, to avoid upsetting Washington and also derailing the general election campaign. The case rested almost entirely on Fuchs's own confession. Fuchs had resigned himself to death. When his counsel asked if he knew the maximum penalty, he replied bleakly, "It looks to me like death." His lawyer corrected him. The maximum was 14 years. The death penalty didn't apply because he wasn't charged with treason, since Britain wasn't officially at war with the Soviet Union. Fuchs recalled, "It was a shock. For someone who has come to terms with the end of his life, suddenly you are told you will continue to live. You have to get used to the idea." The betrayal shook Washington to its core. General Leslie Groves blamed Britain and MI5 for letting a spy slip through. Britain's hopes of reviving economic cooperation with the U.S. were shattered. Senator Joseph McCarthy seized the moment, delivering his famous speech claiming that 205 communists had infiltrated the State Department. Inside the Atomic Energy Commission, Louis Strauss argued that if the Soviets already had the atomic bomb, they were surely racing for something far more powerful, the hydrogen bomb. Fuchs had already told Moscow back in 1945 that American scientists were contemplating such a weapon, 1,000 times more powerful than the atomic bomb. In 1950, Truman authorized its development. The U.S. tested its first H-bomb in 1952. The Soviets followed just 3 years later. After serving 9 years of his 14-year sentence, Fuchs was released in June 1959 for good behavior. As he was about to be released, Rudolf Piles reached out with a letter offering support of any kind, financial assistance or help in finding an academic position.
And Fuchs never replied. And he had no contact with the Pileses at all for the rest of his life. And to me, I think that that really was the nearest I got to understanding his shame. Betraying a country, he wasn't betraying a country at all, he was following an ideal, but betraying the only people who loved him was something he couldn't handle.
Fuchs settled in East Germany and became deputy head of the Central Institute for Nuclear Research near Dresden, and later a professor at Dresden Technical University. He married Greta Kielsen, a communist official he had known since fleeing Nazi Germany. The KGB never forgave him for confessing. In the eyes of the KGB, he was a disgrace. In the eyes of the West, a traitor. In the eyes of history, the man who brought the world closer to the brink of annihilation. The Klaus Fuchs story shows just how powerful scientific knowledge can be. It can change the world for better or for worse. The same tools of math, science, programming, and AI are what drive innovation today. That's why I love using Brilliant. Brilliant helps you truly understand these concepts, not by memorizing formulas, but by solving problems interactively. I highly recommend their science courses, where you'll learn to think like a scientist or engineer with their lessons on electric and digital circuits, gear systems, physical structures, and more. Brilliant's newly updated math courses are designed to make you a better problem solver. You can start at a level that's comfortable for you and work your way up from there. No matter your interest, there's something for you, from learning how to code to exploring data science courses that teach you to spot trends and make smarter decisions. I personally like to take 10 to 15 minutes out of my day to go through Brilliant's logic courses. It's like a daily workout for your brain that's helped me become a better thinker. You can try Brilliant completely free. Just visit brilliant.org/newsthink or scan the QR code on your screen. That's brilliant.org/newsthink. The link is in the description. You'll also get 20% off an annual premium subscription, giving you unlimited access to Brilliant's thousands of lessons. Thanks for watching. For NewsThink, I'm Cindy Palm.